In the previous part, we showed how to create instances of an object on a set of selected vertices. However, the orientation of these instances was unaffected by the normals of the target mesh. In this part, we'll write a script which creates instances of an object and properly aligns these instances to a set of selected faces. Let's start by storing the user's current selection. Use the OS and FL flags to make sure the returned array is properly ordered and flattened. Instead of filtering for vertices, we'll use the filter expand command with the selection mask set to 34 to filter for polygon faces. Next, we'll store the first object selected in the object-to-instance variable. We'll also use the following if statement to check if the object-to-instance is a transform. Use a for-in loop to iterate over each selected face. For each face, create a new instance of the object. The next step is to determine the world coordinates of the face's center point. To do this, we'll create our first function at the top of our script. We'll call it getFaceCenter. Functions in MEL are created with the proc keyword. Since we want our function to provide the XYZ coordinates of the face's center, we'll set its return type to vector. This function will only require one input parameter, the name of the face whose center point we want to calculate. Like variables, input parameters can have any name. We're using the lowercase p prefix here to help us identify the variables which we've declared as function parameters. This is a personal coding style, which can be helpful to quickly identify the scope of a specific variable. Although we still have to fill this function out, we can still call it from within our for loop. Back in our function, add a call to XForm with the following flags. You can think of XForm as a Swiss Army knife when it comes to setting and querying transform information for objects and components. In this case, the Q flag causes the XForm command to enter query mode. In the command reference, commands and flags which support query mode are denoted by the Q property. Here, we're querying the translation value of the given face in world space coordinates. Because a face is composed of several vertices, the result will be an array of vectors which describe the world space positions of these vertices. The average position of these vertices corresponds to the face's center point. We're assuming here that the face is planar. Initialize the sum variable to the vector 0, 0, 0. Vectors in MEL are constructed using two angle brackets. Use a for-in loop to iterate over each vertex position. Add the current vertex position v to the sum vector using the plus operator and store the result back into the sum variable. Next, declare the average variable, which will contain the average vertex position. To compute this average, we'll need to know the total number of vertices by which to divide the sum of the positions. That total number of vertices corresponds to the size of the vertex positions array. We can now perform the scalar division of the sum of the positions by the total number of vertices. The last line in our function is the return statement. In the unlikely case that the XForm command returns an empty array, our scalar division could produce an unhandled division by zero. In other programming languages, you could surround this division with a try-catch block to deal with the exception. In MEL, this is done by surrounding a statement with a catch command and dealing with the result in an if statement. If an exception occurs, the catch command will return 1, which will cause the script to enter the body of the if statement. Here, we'll print the error message, and we'll assign a vector of 0, 0, 0 to the average variable before returning. Given the structure of our script, a division by 0 is unlikely to occur, however, we'll choose to play it safe. Back in our initial for loop, call the move command to place each new instance at the center of its given face. To test our script so far, remove all the grouped arrows in the scene and create a small cube. Select the cube first, then hold Shift to select the faces of the sphere. When we run the script, the instances of the cube are effectively positioned at the center of each selected face. The next major step is to orient these instances according to each face's normal vector. To that effect, we'll create a new function called getFaceNormal. This function will accept the name of the face as an input and will return the face's normal vector in world coordinates. Remove the cubes we had just instanced and open a new tab in the script editor with Ctrl-T. Select one of the faces to see how we can use the polyinfo command with the FN flag to access the face's normal vector. You'll notice that the result is printed in a human-readable format, so we'll need to parse that information. Select the previous MEL tab to continue working on our script. Store the result of the polyinfo command in a new string array. Since we're only dealing with one face at a time, we'll only be interested in parsing the first item in the array. Initialize an array of strings called items. Call the tokenize command to store each space-separated word or number as its own string in the items array. Given the layout of the string to parse, we know that the x component of the normal vector will be located at index 2. Similarly, the y and z components will be respectively stored at indices 3 and 4. By assigning these variables this way, MEL takes care of converting the string values into decimal floating point values. We can now use these variables to construct our normal vector. This vector is defined in the object's local coordinate system. However, since the rest of our script is working in world coordinates, we'll need to convert this vector to its world space equivalent. In other words, our goal is to multiply the normal vector with a transformation matrix which converts local coordinates into world coordinates. First, we'll need to chain two calls to list relatives using the parent flag. The first call to list relatives returns the face's parent shape node. A shape node has at least one parent transform node, which determines where in space the object is positioned, rotated, and scaled. We're only interested in the parent transform node of the given face, which is why we're using list relatives to move up by two levels in the hierarchy. Call the xform command in query mode on the first item in the parent transform array. The M and WS flags return the transform node's local to world space transformation matrix. Call the point matrix melt command to apply this matrix to the normal vector. The result is the world space version of the normal vector, which will convert to a length of 1 with the unit function before returning it. Now that we've defined the getFaceNormal function, let's call it in our for loop. With the position and normal vectors in hand, we now have enough information to properly position and align each instance. Let's create the moveAlign function to complete this task. Let's also comment our placeholder move command in the for loop and call moveAlign instead. The idea here is to apply some linear algebra to compute the face's tangent plane with the given normal vector. We'll compute the first tangent by obtaining the unit length cross product of the normal vector with the y-axis. If the normal vector is parallel to the y-axis, our first tangent will have a magnitude of 0. In that case, we can hard code its value to 100, which we know is perpendicular to the y-axis. We'll compute the second planar tangent by taking the unit length cross product of the normal vector with the first tangent. Using this technique, we've identified three orthonormal vectors, which is to say that these three vectors are perpendicular to one another and they each have a magnitude of 1. With these vectors, we can apply a very useful linear algebra trick. The key matrix property we'll be using is that the rows of a rotation matrix also describe the space's orthogonal basis. Since we already computed this basis, all we need to do now is fill out the rotational component of a 4x4 transform matrix with these vectors. Fill the top row with the xyz components of tangent 2 and set the fourth element to 0. Repeat this process for the second row with the normal vector and the third row with tangent 1. By setting the rows in this order, the resulting scaling factor will remain positive. We can now fill the last row with the position vector, making sure that the fourth element is set to 1. Finally, call the xform command on the object with the WS and M flags to set its local to world transform matrix. To see if our script works, select the cube, then select the faces of the sphere. Select the newly created cubes and open the Move tool settings. Make sure the Move axis is set to object mode. When we move the cubes, you'll notice that they remain properly aligned to the surface of the sphere. Let's add this script to our shelf as finst. We can also save this script to our file system as faceinstances.mel. In the next part, we'll change gears by looking at how to create NURBS curve controllers to help pose and animate objects in the scene.